Good morning, everyone.
Good morning, Jacob.
Let's start with song number 19. Song number 19. Let's stand as we sing. Song number 19. We worship and adore you.
We need a place to put our lives.
I agree. We should be recycled.
All right, song number 19, we worship and adore you.
19.
Thank you.
roll is called up yonder.
Old, and he was strapped to the bed, knocked out. They had given him drugs to help his body calm down. He had come in just super high on drugs, and his family had called. He was really wild and going crazy with them. And when he came in, he was wild and crazy, so they had given him some stuff to knock him out. You never know what they're going to be like when they wake up. So I'm getting a report, and he's strapped down to the bed. I'm thinking, okay, all right. So he starts waking up, and he's actually a really nice guy. So we take him out of the restraints, and then the doctor puts in the discharge order. And I give him the phone to call his family to come pick him up from the hospital so he can go back home. And he starts making these calls. He called a couple people, and then he just sits on the bed and he just starts crying. And I went over and I said, "What's wrong?" And he said, "Nobody wants to come pick me up." And it's not an unusual problem that we have. It's amazing how many people come to the hospital and they are completely alone. Well, this boy had family, but he had kind of burned all his bridges. And so I said, "Well, who did you talk to?" And he said, "Well, my brother, but he doesn't want to come pick me up? I said, okay. I said, well, what's his phone number? So I called him and I said, you know what, you do need to come pick up your brother, but here's some resources. And I told him, you can take him from here directly to Team Challenge and get him in there. He needs some help. So he said, okay. But it just stood out to me just how that desperate look on that young man's face, that his family didn't want to have anything to do with him. He just felt so alone. I want to talk today about loneliness and how that, I think there is so much loneliness in our society. I think we talk a lot about COVID as the pandemic, but loneliness is an epidemic in our society. There are so many lonely people around us. And Mother Teresa actually calls it the leprosy of the modern world. And I found, as I was looking up this topic, Psychology Today, not that we get everything, guidance from Psychology Today, the magazine, but I thought this was really good. It says, to be happy, we need intimate bonds. We need to be able to confide. We need to feel like we belong. We need to be able to get and give support. In fact, strong relationships are key, perhaps the key, to a happy life. And in coming here, I can I got really excited because I see that everybody here has really good, strong relationships and connected and happy and enjoying. So I don't know if this describes you when we talk about loneliness today or not, but maybe this other definition will help us understand a little bit more. Loneliness is an unpleasant emotional response to perceived isolation. Loneliness is also described as social pain, a psychological mechanism which motivates individuals to seek social connections. Loneliness is also a subjective feeling and not the same as solitude. Loneliness can be felt even when we're surrounded by other people, which that's pretty strong right there. We can be around a lot of people, and you can feel very lonely. And sometimes even some of the most lonely people are the ones that seem the most outgoing people. So all the lonely people, where do they come from? Where are they going? Maybe you're one of them. Maybe you want somebody to confide in, to care. All of this, all of us at one point or another, I think, have felt loneliness to one degree or another. But I'd like to talk a little bit about why is this? Why do people have this desire, this intense need for connection? And I'd just like to start with Genesis chapter 1 and just recognize that God made humans for relationship. So we're going to talk about relationship with God, relationship with one another. So let's turn to Genesis chapter 1, verse 26. Just start from the beginning. And God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps upon the earth. From this verse, I see that God himself is in relationship. You could say a trinity of persons in such close relationship that you can't think of one without the other. And we could do all kinds of mind games or puzzles trying to figure out what the Trinity is or wrap your mind around that. But this verse here is the first time we see that God is in fellowship with the Trinity, a Trinity of persons. And as we are created in the image of God, we can think about the Trinity, the relationship that God has with the Trinity as the basis for human life as well, because we are created in His image. And I think the basic nature of God is loving community. I think people naturally, they want that. They want to turn to that. We'll talk a little bit later about why the church can often be, it can either be a huge blessing in bringing somebody to God, and it also can be the biggest hindrance in a person's life in coming to the Lord. And some people, they ask, like, what was God doing before He created the world? Like, what was He doing up there? I think that God was enjoying Himself, quite honestly. I think He was enjoying relationship. And where I get that is out of John 17. And let's just turn there, because there's some really important things that Jesus pulls out. This is the model prayer, actually. It's a full chapter of Jesus' prayer for us. And John 17, 3, "And this is life eternal, that they might know You, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom You have sent." So, knowing God, this is eternal living. This is what eternal life is. And then verse 5, "And now, O Father, glorify Thou Me with Thine own self, with the glory which I had with Thee before the world was." So Jesus is talking about His relationship with the Father before the world ever was. And He's excited about that. And as we read down and look at verse 21, Jesus wants the same for us, to have that same oneness with Him. And this is His prayer for us. I don't know about you, but I think God, the Father, is hearing and answering the prayers of Jesus. "That they all may be one, as Thou, Father, art in Me, and I in Thee, that they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that You have sent Me." So that's Jesus' prayer for us, that we would be one, like the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit are one. It's pretty close. Another thing I thought about in relationship to this, we see a lot more of this now with the cell phone. Everybody wants to take a picture or a video. Why is that? Why do people want to take pictures? They want to capture that experience that they had, and either, as Lenita said, memories, to save it for later and come back, and I want to capture this experience. Or you also, on the social media, we see people, they want to share those experiences with others. And that's human nature. That's intimacy, is shared experiences. And definitely from the social media standpoint, we can use it either for good or for evil, and it goes both ways. So man is created for intimate relationship, intimate fellowship. So let's go back to Genesis chapter 2, look a little bit more at the creation of man. And we'll just read, starting at verse 6, Genesis chapter 2 and verse 6. "There went up a mist from the earth and watered the whole face of the ground. And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. And man became a living soul." This is very different than the animals, how they were made. "And the Lord God planted a garden eastward in Eden, and there He put the man whom He had formed. And out of the ground made the Lord God to grow every tree that is pleasant to the sight and good for food. The tree of life also in the midst of the garden, and the tree of knowledge of good and evil. So it's a little bit how man was created, and then we're going to jump down to verse 15. And the Lord God took the man, put him in the Garden of Eden to dress it and keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden you may freely eat, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat of it. For in the day that you eat thereof, you shall surely die. And the Lord God said, it is not good that the man should be alone. I will make a helpmeet for him. And out of the ground the Lord God formed every beast of the field and every fowl of the air. And he brought them to Adam to see what he would call them. And whatsoever Adam called every living creature, that was the name thereof. Biology class there. And Adam gave names to all the cattle and to the fowl of the air and to every beast of the field. But for Adam there was not found a helpmeet for him. And the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon Adam, and he slept. And he took one of his ribs, and he closed up the flesh and stood thereof. And the rib which the Lord had taken from man made he a woman, and brought her unto the man. And Adam said, this is now bone of my bones, and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, because she was taken out of man. Therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother, and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh. And they were both naked, the man and his wife, and were not ashamed. So it's not good for man to be alone. And rightly so, I think this passage is often turned to at weddings, and these principles are pulled out, presented before the couple and the congregation. And I think that it's right that we do that. But I think there's also even more in this passage about that idea of not good for the man to be alone. I believe, and I see that the Bible teaches, that lonely people are people who live apart from God. We're going to look a little bit later at how God comes down to have a conversation in the garden with Adam, and he's asking, where are you? And I guess I never really thought about this before, but I think God gave Adam and Eve that space in the relationship to where God hid their whereabouts from himself so that man would have the ability to either, you know, come on their own free will or else hide. And so he asks that question, where are you? So lonely people are people who live apart from God. They live without hope and without God in the world, alienated from God and God's people. And I get that out of Ephesians 2, verse 12. So God calls us into relationship with him. So God gave Adam that space to respond, and he still does that. He doesn't force himself upon us. He doesn't force a relationship. So it's up to us. He would like a relationship with us. I think it's up to us to come to him or receive his invitation. And God does that today as well. He comes down and asks us, where are you? Where are you? I want to visit with you. What happened after Cain killed Abel? Genesis 4, I'm not going to read the whole chapter, we're just going to work our way through here. It's a lot of important things, I think. So essentially, God comes down and has a counseling session with Cain after he kills Abel, and he curses the ground, and he cursed the ground and alienated the ground from Cain. He said, "What you put in the ground, it's not gonna grow like it used to for you." And what does Abel say in verse 13 and 14? He says, "My punishment is too great to bear, since you are banishing me today from the soil, and I must hide myself from your presence and become a restless wanderer on the earth, and whoever finds me will kill me." In other words, I'm going to be lonely. There's nobody that's going to care about me anymore, and I can't bear that. But the story doesn't end there. When I came across this, I thought this was the most interesting thing ever. Then what happens? So Cain and his wife have a boy, and they name him Enoch. And what do we know about Enoch? Enoch was the one who, he walked with God. He had such a close relationship with God that God didn't allow him to die. He just took him. So I thought that was such a contrast from Cain, feeling so lonely and banished, to having a son that was so close with God that God just took him. So I thought that was really cool. And really, the entire story of the Bible is all about God calling out a people for himself. Exodus, you see God teaching the people how to set up a dwelling place where God can come down and be with his people. And then how does God distinguish his people from other people? Exodus 33:16. I'll read that. Exodus 33:16. Well, let's start at verse 14, actually. Exodus 33:14. And he said, "My presence shall go with you, and I will give you rest." And he said to him, if your presence go not with me, carry us not up hence. This is Moses talking with the Lord. So if you don't go with us, don't even send us. "For wherein shall it be known here that I and my people have found grace in your sight? Is it not that you go with us? So shall we be separated, I and your people, from all the people that are upon the face of the earth." So the New Testament calls us to live separate from the world. And what does that look like? Some groups choose to be very careful in making sure they dress a certain way, do things a certain way, and some of that is important. But the main separating factor from us and the world is that God's presence is with us. So that's true biblical separation from the world. And then we can experience alienation or rejection because we are alienated from God. So that's, like, I guess the main meat of the message this morning that I would like to point out is that when we come into fellowship with God, then it gives us the framework, the ability to then fellowship with those around us. The psalmist puts it really well in Psalm 16:11. Many of us may know this by memory. Psalm 16:11. "You will show me the path of life. In your presence is fullness of joy." In your presence there is fullness of joy. "At your right hand there are pleasures forevermore." So it's that relationship with God that the psalmist is talking about. Or Psalm 23, right? "Walking through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil." Why? "For you are with me. You are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. Only God can truly take away that feeling of loneliness. I think God puts that in us for a reason, because he wants us to seek him. He wants us to know him. He made us in his image. And I think this is why it explains ultimately, the eternal punishment of hell is separation from God. And I think that explains that punishment a little bit more clearly when we look at how much we need God and how scary that would be without him. And again, the psalmist brings this out in Psalm 51, verse 11, where he says, "Cast me not away from your presence and take not your Holy Spirit from me." It's almost like he's just in terror. Don't put me out of your presence. Don't take your Holy Spirit away from me. I need you. And one theologian, Dallas Willard, I like listening to him a lot and reading his books. "God is able to penetrate and intertwine himself with the fibers of the human self in such a way that those who are enveloped in his loving companionship will never be alone." And that is true, because we have children and we love them with everything inside in a way that we never loved anybody before. And you want everything that's best for that child. You want them to just, you want to be there, you want to protect them, you want to fix all their problems, but there is so much that you really just, you can't do. And especially, I'm sure, as you, a lot of you know, well know, with adult children, when they grow up and leave, there's so much you can't protect them from. You can't protect them from the world. You can't always be there with them. But God truly can. He can truly make a difference for us. And Romans 8:35, 37 through 39, this is like the pinnacle of the chapter, pinnacle of the book, actually, of Romans. It's like the mountaintop experience. Look at chapter 8, Romans 8. "Who shall separate us from the love of Christ?" It's right there. And he goes through the list. "Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? As it is written, for thy sake we are killed all day long. We are counted sheep for the slaughter. But no, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus our Lord." And amen. We are more than conquerors because of God's presence in our lives, and we can count on that. Or Hebrews 13, 5 and 6. Let's turn there real quick. And I always used to think it was interesting that it says, it starts out with, "Let your conversation be without covetousness, and be content with such things as you have. For he has said, I will never leave you or forsake you." Why is that connected? Is there some mistake here that it just moved on to a different topic? But I think when we start looking around to fulfill our desires elsewhere, we're not content, then we're not going to want God's presence with us. But if we're content, if God has put us, we're thankful in every circumstance, then we will be comforted by the fact that God is with us. us or forsake us. We don't need to wrestle our circumstances to fit what we want, but rather we can give thanks and allow God to, his presence, to make us a conqueror in our situation. And this does not mean that nothing bad will ever happen to us, but it does mean that whatever evil may come, we are still beyond genuine harm because his presence is enough. Just like we read in Romans 8, God's presence is enough. A few more things I'd like to talk about. Some people, I feel like they have trouble moving further in their relationship with God, partly because they can't seem to get past just the rules, the commands, God's telling, you know, this is what we need to do. So they focus on the commands and the, this is, you know, what is God telling me to do, where is it going? And maybe we could start there. Maybe that's a good place to start, you know, get excited about what God is wanting us to do. But I don't think it should end there. And I don't think that because Jesus said, I don't call you my slaves, I call you my friends. And a slave doesn't know what his master is doing, but the friend does. The friend is able to have that relationship with each other. And God wants the same from us. His intent for us is that we would grow to the point where we would want what he wants and do without being told. I don't know if you've ever had workers under you. You like it when they take initiative rather than just doing exactly what you tell them and then sitting back and waiting for more commands. Well, take some initiative and, like, you know, see what needs to be done and do it. And I think God is like that with us as well. He'd like us to not just, what did he tell in the parable of the servants who, he was out working in the field and then came in and he made his master dinner and stuff. He said, I'm just an unprofitable servant. I was just doing what I'm supposed to do. But if we go above and beyond and step out instead of just waiting to be told everything, I think that's where God would like us to be. And Paul, he describes himself as a slave of Jesus Christ. You'll see him talking about that a lot in his epistles. Paul, bondservant, slave of Jesus Christ, called to be, you know, blah, blah, blah. I think Paul didn't start there as a slave. I think that's like the next level. If you look at the Old Testament, there were slaves there where they were free. They had the option of attaching themselves with the master. They would stick it all through the ear, and they were recognizing that I'm gonna serve this. I think that's where Paul got to. Went above and beyond there. He wasn't driven into submission, he was drawn into submission. And that's the kind of place that we want to be. And I think people that, like that, who have learned to know God in that kind of way, they're very interesting, unique kind of saints. Just the fun people to meet because they're just unique. They think outside the box. They're different. This fun character. And that's, I mean, sinners, I think, are boring because they're just molded into the same worldly mold that Satan puts everybody into. But God makes creative people. And I think something to keep in mind when we work on a relationship with him. And as I said earlier, some there are people you'll meet out there who, like, will have, I don't mind talking about having a relationship with God. I think that's great. I'm a spiritual person. But I don't want to have anything to do with the church or other people like that. There's just, it's too scary. It's a mess over there. And in some ways you can understand why sometimes, but the Apostle John makes it very clear that if you can't love your brother or sister whom you can see, then how can you say that you love a God who you can't see? Getting that out of 1 John 4:20. But let's talk a little bit about why this is the case. Why it's so important that we as a church are together and love one another. John 13:35. Very key. John 13:35. By this shall all men know that you are my disciples, if you have love one to another. And we could also say that the greatest hindrance to someone coming to God, as we talked about earlier, is when people who call themselves disciples of God and don't have that testimony of love for one another. And that can be the biggest hindrance. Just like love for one another is the greatest argument for the existence of God, the same lies true when we mar that, and it makes it very difficult for people to come to God. And people can do very hurtful things to one another. Jesus said it's better if you were to tie a millstone around your neck and be drowned in the sea than for you to harm one of these little young in faith people and cause them to stumble. As we talked about earlier, intimacy is shared experiences. Sharing close experiences together makes us vulnerable. And so what do a lot of people do? Like, just keep my distance. I don't want to get too close. We'll talk about the weather, but don't want to get too close. One songwriter put it, we used to sing this song a lot in Squaw Valley, the church where I was from up there. I don't know if I've ever seen this song in words or not, so I'm not sure who the writer was, but we was just singing it in gatherings and stuff. He says, you can build a shell around you until no one can get through, and your friends are only those who can do the best for you. You may think this way is easy, but the price you'll pay is high, for you're leaving out the best things in life. It takes courage to care, the chorus here, and it takes courage to care, it takes strength to sympathize. It takes courage to show pity. Yes, it takes a man to cry. There was one who walked before us up the hill to Calvary. He had the courage to care for you and me. And so as we move towards being able to trust one another, trust is a big part of growing in a relationship. We learn to trust God. We learn to trust each other. And really, the only way you can do that safely is in Christ. Because there's conflicting kingdoms, right? There's a kingdom of this world and the kingdom of Christ. And if you're trying to, you know, mix the two, it does not work. So if we want to come together, we come together in Christ. Become the family, the New Testament family. Having the Acts 2 life. Another interesting part of that family dynamic is when Jesus first called people to repent and accept the kingdom of God, a lot of them, he had them forsake their families. Now I'm gonna go bury my father first. And he said really harsh things like, well, let the dead go and bury their own dead, follow me. It's like, what did he mean by that? Well, I think well, our families, no matter how good of a family you have, we can still, we notice the brokenness closest with those that we're closest with, right? And I think God calls us out of our families to put us into His teaching school, His training school, so that we can go back and work things out in loving community from a new perspective, from a relationship with God. So, don't forget about the people around you. A contemporary songwriter by the name of Brandon Heath, it's kind of an interesting song. He takes it from a perspective of like flying in on an airplane and looking at all the people around you in the airport. That's one of the most fun things to do, watching people. It's because there's so many different people from all over the place, and they're all doing so many different things and going to different places. But this is what he writes. He says, "Looking down from a broken sky traced out by the city lights, my world from a mile high, best seat in the house tonight, touch down on the cold black top, hold on for the sudden stop, breathe in the familiar shock of confusion and chaos, all those people going somewhere, why have I never cared?" And then the chorus, praise, it's a prayer. "Give me your eyes for just one second. Give me your eyes so I can see everything that I keep missing. Give me your love for humanity. Give me your arms for the brokenhearted, the ones that are far beyond my reach. Give me your heart for the ones forgotten. Give me your eyes so I can see. Step out on a busy street, see a girl and our eyes meet. Does the best to smile at me to hide what's underneath. There's a man who just arrived, black suit and a bright red tie. He's too ashamed to tell his wife he's out of work, he's buying time. All those people going somewhere, why have I never cared?" And I've been there a million times, a couple of million eyes just moving to pass me by. I swear I thought I never thought I was wrong. I think he's referring to like just judging people by their looks. "Well, I want a second glance, so give me a second chance to see the way you've seen the people all along. Give me your eyes for just one second. Give me your eyes so I can see everything that I keep missing. Give me your love for humanity. Give me your arms for the brokenhearted, the ones that are far beyond my reach. Give me your heart for the ones forgotten. Give me your eyes so I can see." So we don't want to miss the people around us, right? We go to the gas station, the grocery store, there's people walking by our houses. It could even be in our own home sometimes. We don't want to miss that. And I pray every day as I drive down to work that all the people that cross my path, that there would be at least someone that I would, if they're coming and they're in this fruitful position, that I wouldn't miss that. That I would have God's eyes to see. And when you truly do see with God's eyes the broken and hurting people around Him, you're going to need His grace, because it's a lot. There's a lot of lonely people out there. And you're going to need His help to deal with it. Just yesterday, I had a patient come in. She was 88 years old, and she was very sick. We didn't have any idea what was going on with her, so we're doing a bunch of tests, and we found out that her bowels were pretty much all dead. And the prognosis was pretty much not. She was gonna die from it. So I ended up calling her son and saying, "I think you need to come in and see your mom before she passes." And he wanted to continue with the surgery. They didn't really give her much hope with the surgery either, but he wanted to continue with that. So I was able to coordinate him to see her before she went out to surgery. It may have been the last time you ever saw her. It was one of those moments, you just like, You don't want to miss that. So what do I want to leave you with? We can work on a relationship with God. God wants to have a relationship with us, and that's what's most exciting about this, that God is seeking us out, and all we have to do is just have a conversation with Him. It goes both ways. It's not just God giving us commands, but it's also us talking to Him, and also us listening to Him. So we work on that. If we are lonely, seek His face. If I feel lonely, seek His face. Psalm 27. I'm going to close with this psalm. Psalm 27. It's my dad's favorite psalm. Verse 4. One thing have I desired of the Lord that I will seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire into His temple. Just sitting there and just looking at how beautiful God is and just like inquiring into where God lives. That's the psalmist's heart right here. That's David's heart, that he would just seek God and be able to get to know Him just a little bit more. Verse 8, when you said, seek ye my face, my heart said to you, your face, Lord, will I seek. So God is telling us, seek me. Is your heart responding in this way? Lord, I will seek your face. So I just pray that you will go with God this week. You will seek His face and soak in His presence and enjoy, as the psalmist wrote, that in God's presence there is fullness of joy. May God bless you and keep you. Turn the time back over.
Stand as we sing 393. 393. Near my God to thee. Let's stand if you are able and willing.
Thank you. Let's pray. God, I just thank you for these who come today. And God, I pray for the lonely and that they would be with them. And God, that nobody here would ever feel alone. I pray for Jack as he's going through all these tests and stuff and all the things that are going on in his body, God, that you would just touch him and heal him, God. Let this be a place of healing where, God, you just touch these lives that need touching. And then, God, I pray for this man that came this Tuesday and gave his heart to Christ with me on Tuesday, and he's been living in his car in their parking lot. God, I just pray that he'll come back, and he said he would. And I pray that, God, you'll put your hand on his life and have him come back. Let us minister to the lonely. In Christ's name, amen.
Amen.
Thank you so much.